In another about 30 35 minutes, I would like to give a brief upon what basics of hemodynamics a nurse in the ICU should know. To keep it interactive, I have put some questions in between. And I would like help of Dr. Pritam to read the answers by our by our friends who are listening to this talk, and then we will go ahead. So with this, I will start, and straight away I'll put the first question as to what do you mean exactly by the term hemodynamics, or what do you mean by hemodynamic monitoring? So if I can request our audience staff nurses to kind of type their answers in the chat box, and Dr. Pritam can help me out in reading those. I'll give a little, some time for this so that people can answer.
The first question is, what do you mean by the term hemodynamics? But I'd rather hemodynamic monitoring.
So since this session is for nurses, we'll also keep this option of if they can raise their hand, we will ask them to unmute
Yes.
their mics and speak, sir.
Yes, perfect. In fact, that will be more, I think that will be better.
Yes, sir. So we have someone by the name of Mr. Jiten who has raised his hand. So he can unmute his mic and speak, sir.
Yes, please.
Mr. Jiten, you can unmute your mic and speak.
In the meantime, is there any answer which you have got in the chat box?
Sir, I can just see one that has come from that says blood flow monitoring and blood flow to organs and tissues, then blood flow to the organ and tissues, basic measures of cardiac vascular function.
Okay, not bad. And Jiten,
Monitoring by ABG.
okay, monitoring by ABG may not be really correct answer. And I'll come to the answer, but before that, I would like to ask Jiten to unmute the mic and talk. Okay, so it actually means that it has come from the Greek word haima, that is, it means blood. So anything which is related with the monitoring of the blood pressure or cardiac output, which someone has correctly answered, this is the basic measure of the cardiovascular function, is termed as hemodynamics. And the hemodynamic monitoring per se can be a physical study of flowing blood and of all the solid structures, that is arteries through which it flows. So the blood flows through the arteries, and the study or the dynamic study of the blood flowing through the arteries and their functions, along with the blood pressure and the cardiac output, can be in short termed as hemodynamics. I'm sure our audience may have got this answer. And to be very frank with you, a doctor or a consultant or RMO can actually just kind of assess the hemodynamic of any particular patient, but this is the staff nurse per se at the bedside of the patient and the monitor who is very crucial for decision and execution of any plan as far as the abnormalities in hemodynamics is concerned. So staff nurses at the bedside forms a part and parcel of the very important critical care which we deliver to any sick patient. So what are the indications for hemodynamic monitoring? It could be either a patient who has dehydration or hemorrhage or GI bleed, any patient who has underwent a surgery or who has burns and any other reason for the shock like acute myocardial infarction or cardiomyopathies. So we know that we are talking about different types of shocks, and these are the category of patients who need monitoring in terms of the blood pressure and the cardiac output. So this is how a classical monitor looks like. As we know, this is a pulse rate, this is the blood pressure, and you could see that the blood pressure, which is in the bracket, which is actually a mean blood pressure. And what are the goals of monitoring is to confirm the diagnosis as to which kind of shock is it. Of course, to initiate the management for that particular shock and monitor for the improvement or worsening of that particular patient's condition. So why do you do the frequent monitorings and frequent assessments? Because you want to know whether the patient is improving from what you did or the patient is not improving from what you did. So this gives us a few different questions in our mind as to what is shock and how you treat the shock and how you monitor the shock. So as I know, and as we know, that the shock can be at the basic of any particular pathology where the patient is hemodynamically unstable. So this brings us to another question as to what are the different types of shock you know of. So if someone can answer, raise the hand and answer rather than typing.
Sir, hypovolemic shock, neurogenic, yes, shock, cardiogenic, yes, shock, and yes, some like anaphylactic shock.
Yes.
Or in other also distributive shock also.
Very good. Very good. So she has attempted it quite well, and by and large, in a clinical setting, we divide shock four broad categories. Is hypovolumic, which you have answered, cardiogenic, which you have answered, distributive, or also it's called as a septic shock, and obstructive shock, which is related to the obstruction of the pulmonary vasculature. And the commonest example of obstructive shock is pulmonary embolism. So remember these four very basic types of shock in the clinical practice. And shock is basically, it is failure to deliver and utilize adequate amount of oxygen. So as we know that any body tissue in our body will need oxygen and glucose for their metabolism. Importantly, it is oxygen. And what carries oxygen from the heart to the different areas of the body is basically with the help of blood, and this is what we are looking at. So whether the blood flow is there at any vital areas which are responsible for abnormality in the body. So this is the definition of shock. I'm sure is my cursor visible, Dr. Pritam?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is the circle which I'm making is basically for the definition of the shock, and the other circle now which I'm making is for the types of shock. I think I'm pretty much clear at this point in time. Now, as far as the different hemodynamic monitorings are concerned, let us start with very basic is the heart rate, the blood pressure, circulating blood volume, the preload, cardiac output, oxygen delivery to various tissues, oxygen consumption by the tissues, and the tissue perfusion and oxygenation. Now, amongst all these, the last three basically comes into something called as advanced hemodynamic monitoring. And that will need different tools to monitor these particular physiological parameters. So for the sake of today's topic, we will probably restrict ourselves to the remaining five, which forms the basic monitoring of hemodynamics rather than the advanced hemodynamic monitoring. So what are the types of hemodynamic monitoring? In ICU, you must have seen that patients are with non-invasive blood pressure cuff, or they can be with an intra-arterial line. So these are the types of very basic tools for hemodynamic monitoring. As I said, it deals with arterial blood pressure or cardiac output, and we'll come to the relation of these two. But by and large, for the sake of simplicity, if I want to monitor the blood pressure of the patient in ICU, I will first go with non-invasive blood pressure, that is NIBP. If the indication exists, then I would go with the invasive arterial pressure monitoring and the invasive hemodynamic monitoring. So it can either be a continuous, as we see in intra-arterial blood pressure monitoring, or intermittent, as in case of non-invasive blood pressure monitoring with the non-invasive blood pressure cuff. So these are the things which someone needs to remember. These are the examples of other non-invasive hemodynamic monitoring modalities, like heart rate, the mental status, the skin mottling, temperature, capillary refill, urine output, and pulse oximetry. So this looks very simple on one slide, but when it really when you are in an ICU and you are supposed to see all these, you should really make attempts to make sure that you don't miss on these basic parameters. Definitely helpful in assessing the hemodynamics of any. Heart rate, and anyone who has tachycardia, that is heart rate of more than 100, can have problems in his or her hemodynamics. Anyone with a heart can have problems with the hemodynamics. Of arrhythmias. Okay, so if you have anyone with a heart rate of more than 100, or with a heart rate of less than 60, you have to be really, really cautious and watchful. So the other one was blood pressure, and this is how the blood pressure cuff looks like on a patient. As you could see, that it is applied on the arm, and the automated blood pressure monitoring devices measures the blood pressure on an intermittent basis. We should be very sure that it has appropriate cuff size. And in presence of hypotension or arrhythmias, mind you that these non-invasive blood pressure cuffs can be less accurate. So your intensivists or your seniors in the ICU who take rounds can actually insist upon inserting the intra-arterial blood pressure monitoring for these patients, those who have hypotension, that is blood pressure of less than 90, and arrhythmias, where I just touched upon whether heart rate is more than 100 or heart rate is less than 60, there could be the chance of arrhythmias. Mind you, there should be properly sized blood pressure cuffs. So the width of the bladder or the width of this particular, this size should be at least 2/3 of the upper arm, and the length of this particular cuff should be should encircle about 80% of the arm. And the lower edge of the cuff should be approximately 2.5 centimeters above the antecubital space. So this is probably wrongly placed, as you could see, that you cannot see the antecubital fossa here. And ideally, it should be 2.5 centimeters above the antecubital fossa. These are the specifications of the non-invasive blood pressure cuff. So it should not be too small, or it should not be too large. So if it is too small, it can cause falsely high reading. And the other way around, if it is too large, it can cause falsely low reading. Coming to the invasive arterial pressure monitoring, you should know what are the indications of the same. Basically, they are the ones who have hypotension, as I have already told you, those who are on vasoactive drips, that is inotropes, or the patients with labile blood pressures, the patients who need frequent arterial blood gas analysis or labs, and those who don't, we are unable to obtain a non-invasive blood pressure, like there is too much of a swelling, the patient is too obese, the blood pressure cuff cannot fit properly, and things like that. What are the sites of invasive pressure monitoring? It could be either radial artery, which is the most preferred one, brachial artery, femoral, and the least preferred is dorsalis pedis. The complications of the same are, it could be hematoma or the blood loss. The artery can have a thrombus, so there can be thrombosis, distal ischemia, arterial injury, and infection. So anyone who is monitoring a patient with the invasive arterial pressure monitoring, you should be very careful of, having a watch on potential complications which are mentioned here for that particular patient. Remember the tubings and the transducer, which should be ideally replaced every 96 hours, that is 4 days. This is a practical point which you should remember. So this brings me to my third question, that is, on which factors does the blood pressure depend upon? So anyone's blood pressure, you should have which two physiological parameters for you to calculate the blood pressure. I'm sure it is not very easy and it's not a formula as such, but they can be dependent on very, very important two other physiological parameters. Can someone tell me? Can someone please tell me?
We've got a... No, please go ahead.
Cardiac output.
Yes, very good. And what else?
Heart rate. Sir, heart rate, diameter of the vessel.
Uh-huh.
Heart rate, diameter of vessel.
Diameter, can you be little more specific as to what do you mean by diameter? Sir, ultimately, sir, it will depend on the resistance, isn't it?
Yes, yes, sir, yes, sir.
So you want to say that it should be systemic vascular resistance, I suppose.
Yes, sir.
So in that case, you are absolutely right. May I know your name, please?
I am Mamta Gelot from AIIMS Bhubaneswar.
Great. Sir, so you work with Dr. Sharmili, if I am not wrong.
I am critical care student.
Good. So you are absolutely right. The blood pressure indirectly depends upon two very important physiological parameters, that is cardiac output and systemic vascular resistance. And Ms. Mamta, you answered the other part of this as well, that ultimately the cardiac output depends upon the heart rate. And of course, it also depends upon the contractility of the heart, isn't it? So that is a very good answer. At the same time, the systemic vascular resistance depends upon the vascular tone, the catecholamine level in the body, and the blood viscosity. So if the blood is more thick or blood is more thin, depending on that, your systemic vascular resistance can change. But by and large, this MAP stands for mean arterial pressure, which is given by invasive arterial pressure monitoring. When you see a systolic pressure and a diastolic pressure, and you see one more pressure in the bracket of the monitor, and that is the mean arterial pressure. That depends on cardiac output and systemic vascular resistance. Very good. So this is how the invasive BP monitoring looks like. This is the invasive line, and this is the real time from my own ICU. As you could see that there is a radial arterial line, and it is written that A line, and do not give any medications from this A line. It is labeled here like this, which is very important. This is how the arterial line looks like. This is put into the radial artery, and this is the transducer, which you can see, and this is the pressure bag, which is to be attached to the transducer unit, and this is how the blood pressure is monitored. So you know how the arterial line looks like now, and you also know physiologically how it depends on what other things. Now, can someone tell me what is the name of that reference point for the ideal level of the transducer which has to be placed? As you could see that in this particular slide, these are the transducers. So can someone tell me what is that point called, and it corresponds to what particular structure in the human body?
हेलो
यस
सर, फ्लेबोस्टेटिक एक्सिस पर हमें मॉनिटर करना होता है सर.
वेरी गुड, वेरी गुड. सो कैन यू प्लीज टेल मी वेयर फ्लेबोस्टेटिक एक्सिस इज?
सर, फोर्थ इंटरकोस्टल स्पेस सर, चेस्ट, फोर्थ इंटरकोस्टल स्पेस.
वेरी गुड. एंड इट करस्पोंड्स टू व्हिच पार्ट ऑफ द हार्ट? It is the right atrium at which we put the level of the transducer. You are absolutely correct. As you could see that this is called the phlebostatic axis. I think your name is Jyoti.
Ji sir.
Very good, Jyoti. So this is the point of the phlebostatic axis where the transducer level is to be placed. It corresponds to the right atrium in the heart. You can please mute yourself, Jyoti. Yeah, so this is the transducer level. If the transducer level goes above that particular level, then the reading will be falsely low. And if the transducer level goes below the phlebostatic axis, then the readings will be falsely high. So remember, when the phlebostatic axis, the point at the the transducer goes below this, the levels will be falsely high. And if the level goes above this, then the readings will be falsely low. So it is opposite of that. This is how the arterial line trace looks like. As you could see, this is 113 is the systolic blood pressure, 69 is the diastolic blood pressure, and a mean blood pressure is 86. And as you know, can somebody please tell me what is the formula for mean blood pressure and what is the pulse pressure in this particular case? Can someone tell me? What is the pulse pressure? Okay, so I will tell. Pulse pressure is systolic pressure minus diastolic pressure, is called as the pulse pressure. Okay, and the mean arterial pressure depends on the diastolic pressure. So it is diastolic pressure plus 1/3 of the pulse pressure is what is the formula for mean arterial pressure. Just remember this. Now, when you have certain monitoring systems like this, so you, in this monitor, you can see that there is an invasive intra-arterial pressure. At the same time, there is a CVT also. Am I correct? So this is an arterial line and this is a central line. So you have to zero this transducer. So when you are doing a zero, you can see that this becomes straight line. When you do the zero of a transducer, you have to close the transducer to the patient and open it to the atmosphere. This is the basic of zeroing of the transducer. And when you do a flush test, it is called as a flush test. When you are zeroing, I'm sure those who have done that will understand what I am saying. It is called as a flush test when you are zeroing. So when you flush the transducer, and after the flushing, if you see a trace like this with a dichrotic notch of the intra-arterial pressure, a trace like this, a very lousy trace. Lousy means the there are peaks are not very good. It's a very lousy trace. It is called as a overdamped trace. And when you see a very abnormally peak, abnormally sharp graphs like this, then it is a underdamped trace. So you should know what is normal. You should know what is overdamped, and you should also know what is underdamped. Am I going very fast, or things are okay? Is that okay?
So there's nothing put up in the chat box, sir. Everyone is putting okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay, fine. I just feel that it should not be very fast. Anyways, so this is how the flush test looks like. When you flush the transducer, it has a box like this. And after the flush, if there are two oscillations, then this is a normal trace. It is adequately damped. Now, when it is like this, as you could see, that there is a box, but there are more than two oscillations. Ye bahut baar ho raha hai, dekho. Do, teen, char baar ho raha hai. So this is a underdamped trace. This is a underdamped trace. And when the flush test looks like this, that there is only one oscillation, ye yahan pe khali ek baar ho raha hai, aur baad mein lousy trace aa raha hai, so this is a overdamped trace. You should know how a overdamped trace looks like, how a underdamped trace looks like, and how a normal damped trace looks like. Now these are the causes of overdampening and underdampening. So overdampening is because of air bubbles, loose connections, embolisms or clots, and low flush black pressure. All these four things, if you could see a trace which is like a spike, abnormal spike, okay, with more than two oscillations after the flush test. And these are the causes of underdamped trace, where you can see these are the reasons. So stiff tubing or a long tubing or an increased vascular resistance. So underdamped trace can look like what I have showed in the earlier diagrams. Now, what are the nursing implications of the same? That you need to prevent or reduce the potential complications, maintain the back pressure, which I showed you at around 300 millimeters of mercury, maintain the continuous flow through the tubings. You need to have an aseptic dressing and sterile caps on the openings. As I already told you, you need to change the tubings after every 4 days and 5 minutes hold on the discontinuation site. So these are the nursing implications for any patient who has invasive monitoring and the transducer which is in place. The another thing which we usually see is central venous catheter. So you ideally put it either in the internal jugular vein or a subclavian vein. These are the two most preferred central venous line placements. We don't prefer femoral. We prefer either internal jugular or subclavian. So this is how the subclavian line looks like, as you could see in this particular X-ray. And the tip of that particular line should ideally be at the site of carina on the X-ray, which you need to take help. Okay, so this is the ideal placement of the line, as you could see that it is just above the carina. So this is a perfectly placed central line. And now can someone tell me what is this X-ray showing? Can someone identify? So we do an X-ray chest after every central line to see whether the tip is properly placed, and you can see some problem here. Can someone please tell me? Yes. Can someone identify the problem? I will give you a hint. The problem lies on the right side of the lung. So you could see, I will tell the answer. You could see that there is a hyperlucent, there is a more black lung on this side than the left side. It is more white and this is more black because there is a pneumothorax lying on the right side. As you could see, this is a pneumothorax and this is a collapsed lung. Okay, you should know this. Anyways, now CVP or PCWP is basically measure of intraluminal pressures. Under the normal circumstances, the CVP reflects the circulating volume, which is also affected by the venous tone, the ventricular compliance, the myocardial contractility, the afterload, as well as the intrathoracic pressure, the pericardial pressures, and the thoracic and abdominal wall compliance. So what I mean to say by this is CVP is affected by all other things which are surrounding that particular vein. So it can be thorax, abdomen, heart, major vessels, and their compliances and tones. So this is how the central venous pressure looks like, which is opening on the right side of the heart. Then it goes to the lung, then it gets purified, and then it comes out of the lung. From there, the oxygenated blood is pumped by left ventricle to the systemic circulation. And this is the cardiac output, which we have already discussed, which depends upon the heart rate and the stroke volume. And the arterial pressure depends on the cardiac output and the systemic vascular resistance. These are the waves, different waves of CVP. I think I will not go into the details, but just remember there are three positive waves and two negative waves for a CVP. So the three positive waves are A, C, and V, and the two negative waves are X descent and the Y descent. This is how the classical CVP looks like. Okay. Now remember, in a spontaneously breathing patient, when the patient is not ventilated, you need to take CVP at the end of the expiration. So this is the end of the expiration. In a spontaneously breathing patient. Whereas in a patient who is on ventilator or IPPV, you need to, this is the end of the expiration on the CVP graph. So the tallest part is the end of expiration in spontaneous, whereas the lowest part is end of the expiration in a patient who is mechanically ventilated. This is very important. Okay. So this is how the CVP looks like. This is arterial trace and this is the ECG. Okay. Nursing hourly assessment of air in the line, whether the line has precipitates, whether there is any leakage or increasing resistance or condition of the entrance site, everything has to be looked upon by a nurse or a critical care nurse, not to miss on any complications of the same. So as I said, coming to the complications, it can either the central line insertion can have a carotid puncture. It means that there is a puncture of the carotid artery and you need to give pressure and take an X-ray. Always remember, whenever there is bleeding from the body, you have to give pressure on that part, nothing else. You need to look for nerve injury. You have to be very careful of air embolism, and this is the rate at which it is fatal. So about 70 to 300 cc of air, if it goes inside the vein at the rate of 75 to 150 ml per second, then there is a chance of venous air embolism. Other complications can be cardiac tamponade, catheter embolus, rupture, malposition, and so on and so forth. Now, the other part of hemodynamic monitoring can be by echocardiography or sonography. So this is how we can look at the IVC of the patient. And when you look at the IVC, you have to look for the collapsibility of IVC. So if inferior vena cava is distended but not collapsing like this, then it is said that the patient is having a fluid overload. In this case, you have to give Lasix. And if the graft looks like this, where it is collapsible, as you could see. So in this patient, the patient is not in fluid overload and you can still give some IV fluids to the patient. So my another question is, what are the different causes of high CVP?
Sir, sorry to interrupt, but there was a request in the chat box. If you could go to the previous slide, sir.
Okay. Which one?
So the one before this.
Is this the one?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So any particular query on this slide?
Yes, sir. I have asked the participant. Ms. Mamta, you can raise your, you can unmute your mic and speak.
The last line. Backflow from the distal lumen is important.
Yes. So you tell me, why must I have put this sentence? Because you can understand that there can be multiple lumens to a central line. Okay. You must have seen a central line with a single lumen or a double lumen or a triple lumen, or sometimes there can be five lumens also. But important thing is to ensure that there is a backflow from the distal lumen. It means that the distal end of that particular line is well placed inside the vein. Okay, if there is no backflow from the distal lumen, it means that it has gone in an area where the blood is not coming from the distal lumen. In that case, you have to change the line. Is that clear? Am I clear?
Thank you. Yes. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Always remember, that's a very important practical point. So please tell me, what are the different causes of high CVP? When you see the high, by the way, CVP can be normal in the range of around 8 to 12. Okay. So can someone know what is high CVP?
Sir,
over hydration, which increases venous return. So
very good.
Leads to venous congestion, sir.
Very good. Anything else?
Sir, lung heart diseases and then
excellent.
Primary pulmonary hypertension.
Very good. Very good. Excellent.
The right heart failure.
Right. So you should think on the lines whether there is a problem. As I showed you one slide. Okay. I showed you one slide which affects the CVP. So vascular tone, compliance, thoracic problems, abdominal problems, pleural problems, heart problems, lung problems. So I think you have answered quite a bit. So let us come to this slide. So low CVP is mainly because of, let us talk of low CVP. So the low CVP is basically because of the hypovolemia or sepsis because of vasodilatation, and it can also be because of the infection. So again, I'm saying the sepsis and the same thing. And as I said, the high CVP is mainly because of tension pneumothorax. So any pleural problem, heart failure, as someone told me that there is a edema, fluid overload, increase in the fluid status in the body, and very high CVP can be because of pericardial. So remember the structures which are surrounding the heart and the heart itself. Okay. So this particular line is going inside the junction between the right atrium and the superior vena cava. So it is affected by the right atrium. It will be affected by the pericardium. It will be affected by the pleura, and it will be affected by the heart. Okay. So you answered it very nicely. I think this is the repetition of the same slide. one thing which someone told me that you have to have a preload. So the preload is the volume of blood in the ventricles at the end of the diastole. So this is the right side of the heart. Okay, we are looking at the right side when we are looking at the CVP. So if the preload is good, then only your afterload, which means the blood which is pushed or pumped by the left ventricle inside the circulation, will be correct. So if you don't have a good preload, there won't be proper afterload. So afterload is a resistance the left ventricle must overcome to circulate the blood volume. And this concept is very important. So unless you have a good preload, your patient will not have a good afterload, that is good cardiac output. So you have to make, you know, if there is a fluid deficit, you need to give proper to have a good afterload, or that is the cardiac output. So these are the same things. The cardiac output depends on the heart rate and the stroke volume, which ultimately depends on the blood volume and the vascular resistance. This is the cardiac output. Okay. So what is the poor man's cardiac output? Can someone answer? I think I have three minutes, Neil. And I think I will finish into my stipulated time.
No problem, sir.
Can someone tell me what is the poor man's cardiac output? How will you measure the cardiac output of a patient in ICU if I tell you that to any staff nurse that you can do it? You don't need any catheter, you don't need any invasive arterial lines or Schwann-Ganz catheters or PA catheters or IABP, you don't need that. Yes, it's a very common sense and a logical answer.
Hello, sir.
Okay, let me, yes.
Sir, good evening, sir. It's urine output of the patient.
Excellent. Okay. So this is the hourly urine. And may I know your name, please?
Yes, sir. Myself, Hemant MS, sir. Currently, I'm working as a nurse practitioner in MVJ settings. I did NPCC PG residency program in Manipal, sir. Mahe.
Excellent answer. Okay.
Thanks,
so
sir.
This is a very good answer, and I'm really happy for that. So it usually reflects the renal perfusion and the perfusion in the body. Normally, you should have a urine output in the range of around 1 ml per kg per hour. And if it is below 0.5 ml per kg per hour, it is supposed to be an inadequate urine output. And you should look for the causes of hypovolemia or low cardiac output or sepsis in these patients. Very good. This is how the Foley catheter and the hourly urine output measurement looks like. Always ensure that you are measuring the urine output hourly, okay? And not after 5 hours or 6 hours. Now, these are a few of the, views of the echo, which we do it at the bedside to know the hemodynamics. So this is a apical four chamber view. This is a parasternal long axis. This is a parasternal short axis. You know, this is a subcostal view and this is a apical two chamber. The echo images looks like. So these are the examples of advanced hemodynamic monitoring, and I will just, I think this is my last slide, which will give them an overview of what they should be just knowing by reading a bit on all these things like Schwann-Ganz catheter, stroke volume variations, pulse pressure variations, passive leg raising test, mixed venous oxygen, LIDCO, these are all the LIDCO, PICO, these are all the cardiac output monitoring. This is how a cardiac monitor looks like. And this can be very, very easily placed on an invasive arterial line to any patient. As you could see that you can see a cardiac output, systemic vascular resistance, cardiac index, and so on and so forth. Okay, I thank you all for the patient hearing, and I will be happy to take any questions, if any. So, Dr. Pritam, is there any comment from your side, or you have questions for me? Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Srikanth, for a very wonderful lecture. It was a quite comprehensive one, which is very useful for the nurses to understand. And it was well placed and well decisive lecture. I think every concept has been cleared. Anyone has any question regarding this?
No questions in the chat box also, I suppose.
So there is one question, sir. How to monitor whether we are treating correctly?
How to monitor?
Sir, how to monitor correctly.
Someone is talking in the background where you are not very audible, Neil. I think you can. Yeah. How do you know that you are monitoring correctly? I don't know. I mean, I did not understand the question.
I think the question means whether the sisters are saying whether we are monitoring correctly. That means whether regarding A line, it should not be over damp, under damp. If the A line is in correct length, then your A line is correct. Similarly with CVP, like that. I think the question is meaning like they are meaning like this only.
Yeah.
Considering the arterial line.
Okay. Okay. So then, these are there are a few couple of slides which I had in my presentation that you need to make sure that the arterial line is well placed. It is not kinked. Sometimes you can see the kinks, then you should be very sure of any air bubbles or the tubing which is too long or too short, and that the level of transducer at the good phlebostatic axis, it is the level of transducer is not wrongly high or low to the level of phlebostatic axis. I think these are the things which needs to be monitored. Any other?
So we have Karina who has raised her hand, so she has any question.
Yeah, please.
Karina, you can unmute your mic and speak. We have Bharti who has raised her hand. You can unmute your mic and speak.
Yeah, they can. Please unmute your mics, please. Can you please unmute the mic, Sarina? I don't know.
So probably by mistake they have raised.
Okay. Okay, then I think if there are no questions, should we wait for 2 more minutes and then call it a day? It is 5:50.
If there is nothing in the chat box, we can have a concluding remarks and conclude the session.
Yeah, so maybe Dr. Pritam can have a concluding remarks.
Any more questions from anyone?
SVR, someone has said. Please explain.
Please explain it.
Yeah. So if you see that I have actually told you about SPR. In this slide, you can see that this is the systemic vascular resistance. So remember that when the systemic vascular resistance is low, that means the diameter of the vessel is more than normal, you have the same blood volume inside your body. So if the systemic vascular resistance is low, the same volume of the blood will get distributed in the larger surface area because of the larger diameter of the vessel. So the patient can drop his blood pressure because the patient will drop his stroke volume. And that is how it will drop the cardiac output also. So if the patient is vasodilated, there is vasodilatation, means there is dilatation of the vessel, the systemic vascular resistance will be low than normal. In that case, you have to give a drug which will increase the systemic vascular resistance. That means it should vasoconstrict the vessel. So noradrenaline is one drug which can cause vasoconstriction. And with that, you will increase the systemic vascular resistance. And with that, you will increase the stroke volume. And with that, you will increase the cardiac output. So this is how the systemic vascular resistance is to be looked upon. I think I'm clear. Any other question? I think there was a question on in arterial line, if no backflow, should we take the measure as a correct? Okay. So make sure that first of all, you have to inform this to the on-duty senior doctor. It's very important. If you don't have a backflow, it's a very serious issue. Either one thing is you can do at your level is remove the dressing and see whether the line is kinked. Sometimes there is a kink. Sometimes you can see that the line has come out, you know, and no one knows that. So if there is no backflow, you have to be very sure. First of all, you have to inspect, as I can see, show you the slide. This is how the arterial line looks like. So when you don't have a backflow, please open the dressing of the line. Yeah, this slide.
This one.
Please open the dressing like this and see whether this line is well placed or there is any kink. So if you don't have that, then you have to aspirate from here and see whether again if there is any backflow or not. If there is no backflow, you can try and take some saline from here and try to push around 2 or 3 ml from the line again. And still, if you can't do that, then of course you have to inform it to the on-duty intensivist, where they will plan to make sure the patency of that particular line, whether there is any clot or any thrombus or things like that.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in arterial line, in a graph, we can see anacotic notch, dicotic notch, like that. In CVP line, any special measurement is there, sir?
Yes, I showed you that slide. Let me take you to the slide. There are 3 positive waves and 2 negative waves in a CVP. So the 3 positive waves are A, C and V, if you can remember that. So this is the, these are the 3. Can you see this?
Yes, sir. I can see, sir. But A, C, V, what it indicates, sir? Like A, what it indicates?
Yes. So A wave represents the atrial contraction. It is because of the contraction of the atrium. Okay. The C wave, so it is followed by the atrial contraction. There is a C wave, which is due to the bulging of the tricuspid valve when there is early ventricular systole. So first A wave is because of the atrial contraction. C wave is because of the bulging of the tricuspid valve. Okay. And the V wave is basically caused by the atrial filling during the ventricular systole. So the atrium again refills from the blood which is coming from the inferior vena cava. So these are the three positive waves: atrial contraction, tricuspid wall bulging, and ventricular atrial refilling in ventricular systole. Am I okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes. Okay, then I think this is almost 5:56. So.
Yes, sir, we can conclude it, sir.
Yeah. I hope we have answered almost all the questions. Nothing is remaining. I think we have taken the questions.
Yeah.
Just a minute, if I can scroll down. There is one clot, kisi ne to bola hai, but I can't understand that. Okay. Sometimes the port is leaking. Yes. Vasopressin. I did not understand the question. Vasopressin is one of the inotrope. So, pressure should be 300 in the back. Yes. Backflow should be there. Yes. Airbag pressure, I have already said. And I am really thank you for, I think most of them have liked it and they have complimented this on the chat boxes. So I'm really thankful for the same. CVP lines changed, arterial line should be changed. How to monitor whether we are tracing correctly, which we have answered.